Hello everyone, my name is Sushain and welcome to yet another episode of the Flag Goes Up podcast. So the Premier League is less than 2 weeks away. We are less than 2 weeks away from the return of the Premier League. But today's episode is not about that. It is about something equally exciting. We are of course talking about the Fantasy Premier League. Now those of us who play Fantasy Premier League know how mentally draining it can get. It is like being in a toxic relationship with someone. But yeah, so that's how it goes. But yeah, so to decrease the toxicity in your relationship with FPL, we've come up with this episode wherein we will be discussing about all the tips and tricks for you as well as for us to get a higher rank amongst our mini leagues and obviously overall as well. So for this episode, I have with me Shivang and of course Vikram. So for those of you who don't know, Vikram actually finished last season with 2,491 points and an All India rank of 464. So just to put that into context, my JEE rank from 2014 was 3 lakh something. So if his rank is and only 20 lakh people appeared. Yeah, so and only 20 lakh people appear for JEE, and out of those 20 lakhs, my rank was 3 lakhs. But how many players from India play FPL? Any idea, guys? More than 20 lakhs or?
Yeah, it should be more than 20 lakhs. Come on.
Yeah, at least more
most
than.
Most probably.
And yeah, I mean, given
my parents should be proud. Got,
So if Vikram has an All India rank of 464, I think we should start calling him Professor. And I think I have my notepad ready with me. I hope you guys have as well, because whatever he has to say, I think we should keep a close to note of that. So before we get into it, let's just have Shivang, you know, very quickly take us through the rules. Over to you.
Yeah. So, yeah. Thank you, Sushain. So the rules for the FPL game here, we have the 15 players which you have to choose from your 100 million pound budget. Maximum of 3 players can be chosen from one team or from one team from your squad. 2 goalkeepers, 5 defenders, 3 forwards and 5 midfielders. That's all you can choose from. And the points will be on the basis of the assists, clean sheets, goals scored, or all the assists you make. You know, the budget players.
Negative points if you get a yellow card or a red card.
Yeah, right. Red card, yellow card. Right. And the captain gets twice as the points. Like if you have a captain selecting and you have a captain scoring a goal, so he gets 6 points. He's not like for scoring a goal, and you get twice that points, like 12 points for the captain being the goal scorer. And then 1 free transfer per game. If you choose to, you know, make no transfer in one game week, then you can have 2 transfers for the next week. So it all adds up. And then you have chips like the wild card, bench boost, triple captain, etc., etc. Free hit as well, which was introduced like in the last, I think, 2 or 3 seasons ago only. So all these rules which you need to keep in mind from the playing point of view.
Yeah, that's it. So I hope your rules have been brushed up. So actually what we did before we sat to record this episode was we put up an Instagram post, you know, wherein we asked our viewers and listeners to ask us some of the questions that they would like us to discuss for this episode. So we got a pretty good response. And I mean, I have to say some of those questions were very similar. So what we've done is we've compiled a list of all the questions, and obviously the questions that we found a little similar, we've clubbed those questions into one. So hopefully, you know, if multiple viewers or multiple listeners asked their questions differently, obviously, I hope one question would answer both their questions. Yeah. So my first question, obviously not mine, obviously some of our followers would also had this question, is again, this was my question as well, is, you know, how do you select your team, given the fact that 464 rank from, you know, in India is quite an amazing achievement. So do you go by, you know, do you predominantly use stats? Do you go heavily off team fixtures? Like, do you plan with 3 or 4 fixtures in advance, or do you select players based on based on an eye test, their recent form, or their fixtures, as I discussed, or is it a combination of several of these? So how do we go about selecting our first 11 for game week one? I mean, first 15 for game week one.
Yeah, I think it's definitely a combination of all of these things. Of course, you cannot ignore the fixtures, the first 5 fixtures. Obviously, you choose players who have the easiest 5 fixtures, first 5 fixtures. Yeah. And another thing is how nailed they are in the team, like how guaranteed they are to start every game. you have to choose players that will start every game. You cannot be reliant on like some managers who are notorious to interchange many players, and you cannot trust that. Yeah,
absolutely.
So guaranteed players to start are important, and the most important thing is eye test, I think. Mm-hmm. You have to watch games and know how players perform and who is on top form and who have been the best players from the last season. Those players have to be in your team first. Like some of the big hitters like Salah, Kane and Bruno, and even Trent, Alexander-Arnold. These players have to be in your team, I think. You can choose other players, you can choose some differentials, but I think these players pick themselves. And another thing is how you go about your team is you have to decide on a structure, like a team formation. Mm-hmm. There are options like 3-4-3,
exactly.
Like three defenders, four midfielders, and three forwards. Or you can go 3-5-2 or 4-4-2. Like all of these structures have their own pros and cons.
Absolutely.
If you go for 3-5-2, you go for five midfielders. You have another midfielder, and midfielders get an extra point for scoring as well as an extra point for clean sheet.
Absolutely.
So that is a pro, but a con is that you will lose out on another forward. And in this season, I think there are many forward options in the budget sector, like 7.5 to 8. There are many options, so you lose out on that. And if you go for 3-4-3, you're missing out on a midfielder. So, you know, every formation has a pro and con. If you go for 4-4-2, you have an extra defender, and defenders get 6 points for scoring a goal as compared to a striker who gets four points, and a midfielder get 5 points, as well as the possibility of a clean sheet. But then again, clean sheets are not common. They're not easily gettable. So you have to keep, not guaranteed. Yeah. So keep that in mind. So I think these are the factors that go into picking up your team for the first game week.
Right. Fair enough. Yep. I think it's a brilliant insight that we got.
Exactly. And just, Sushin, just let me add one point here. So absolutely. I agree totally with Vikram here. And he just missed out on this big match player. It's Kevin De Bruyne. Like, he's the one who has been the most consistent midfielders of like 3 to 4 years, 5 years, which has been playing for Manchester City. And he has been one of the very consistent, balanced with the assists and the goals and everything. So he has to be in that lineup.
Right? No, but that's what he said. His manager is the one who gets abuses every game because you never know which player. I mean, he's got such a big squad. He'll rotate players for fun. And obviously, Pep Guardiola is the kind of manager who gives you the most headaches because you never know who he's going to bench and who he's going to start.
Yeah, these headaches are only increasing now. You know, they're going to be increasing with the suspected and the rumored transfers of Jack Grealish and Harry Kane.
Like they didn't have enough midfielders.
Yeah, right.
Even Jack Grealish, who was a kind of a budget midfielder somewhere around 7.5 last year, if this supposed transfer goes through, I think his price is definitely going to increase.
Yeah, man.
Can that happen, actually? I'm not sure about that.
It already did.
Has it?
I think it's... So, His price is 8, I think.
But I think 8, it's still kind of in the budget range. I mean, Kai Havertz is also somewhere around 8.5. So I think 7 to 8.5 is still your budget range. And I think, obviously, I think it'll if the transfer to Manchester City goes through, maybe it could be 10 plus, who knows. But I mean, we'll figure out. I think this is likely to go through. I don't think if the rumored amount of 100 million pounds is true, I don't think Aston Villa would be in their right minds to reject it. So this is turning out to be a transfer episode now. I think we should get back to FPL. So now we've got enough information as to how to build our game to team for the first game week. So my second question, obviously, you know, similar to that, you know, a mix of all the questions that we got earlier. It's obviously it's proven that, you know, we get our points. We get the points from the players who are only in our starting 11. Yeah, as Shivang said, we have to select 15 points. 11 of them are going to be in your starting 11, and 4 of them are going to be on your bench. So obviously, the players who are in your starting 11, you'll get points only for those. So most of the players, what they do is, and this is something that I also used to do before, was that I used to invest heavily in my starting 11. So my bench, who used to be of players four million pounds each. Yeah. So the starting 11 used to cost 84 million pounds and the bench used to cost just 16 million pounds. So is this the right thing to do? I mean, should we have a balanced team across, across defense, across midfield, across, your forward line, so that your bench is also forward, because there is one chip called bench boost where you can use your players from the bench would also get points. So this is one of one question that I have. And obviously, when do we play that first game, first wild card? So these are the two questions that I got, which I've combined, that should we invest heavily in our starting 11 only, like 84 to 16 ratio? And when should our first wild card be used?
Yeah, I think the bench is an important thing. You have to have a decent bench, but I think that's more important in the deep end of the season. Like, you don't need a strong bench at the start. You can have two players minimum who are cheap, but they are in the starting 11s of their team. So if they come on, at least to get an appearance point. But yeah. I think you have to invest in your starting 11 team in the first few game weeks.
And also the one point that Vikram made was that the players that you're selecting for your FPL, you need to make sure that they are playing at least 60 minutes, because if they are playing at least 60 minutes, then you'll be guaranteed 2 points. And obviously, and if that is a defender or a midfielder and he gets substituted after 60 minutes and his team hasn't conceded a goal, he'll get those clean sheet points as well.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes. And talking about the bench and everything, so the bench strength also needs to be, in the beginning of the season, you can go ahead. Like, you can afford to have these cheap players. Like, not cheap, I would say. I'd say players who are of the lesser value. They don't play that much. But yeah, bench boost, you can use this bench boost option. In the meantime, you can use this all the wild card, which you mentioned already. So the playing of this wild card option is like, it's just around the winter break, which it used to be like the first half of the season, just before the first half of the season. We can use wild cards and we can, choose these players who are, bang on the form. Like if we have Bruno Fernandes playing and scoring, G plus A ratio is high again. De Bruyne has a G plus high ratio. Same with Salah, Harry Kane. Even we are talking about Jack Grealish, maybe newcomers. Maybe we have seen defenders also, being on point, getting those clean sheets, getting those goals also. Van Dijk, Harry Maguire, who knows Rafael Varane will score one, things like these. So you need to make sure of these things too.
Yep, fair enough. So yeah, all right. So another question that I had was, and I think this is one of the questions that even I would have asked if we hadn't got it from our viewers, was that normally what we see is that, majority of the players who play, majority of the managers who play the Fantasy Premier League, they invest heavily in midfield and in attack, yeah, as compared to the defense and the goalkeepers, because they're not entirely sure whether the defenders that they are picking will keep a clean sheet game week in and week out. But obviously, if you're selecting players, who are, have a high chance of scoring, the budget strikers, I think Ollie Watkins and Dominic Calvert-Lewin, who did very well last season. And obviously, you have the premium players are from that midfield position, as I said, Salah, De Bruyne, Bruno Fernandes, Heung-min Son as well. So is it a right thing to do that we invest heavily in midfield and in the forward line, and not invest so much defensively in our defense and for the goalkeepers?
Yeah, especially for the goalkeepers, I think you have to have the cheapest goalkeeper, man. Like a 4.5 starting keeper and a 4.0 bench keeper. Because some people I have seen, they rotate their keepers, but end up having lesser points than if you haven't changed your keeper at all.
Absolutely.
So I personally go for the cheapest keeper, and like sometimes you get lucky, like last season Martinez was a 4.5 Absolutely. Keeper and he turned out to be the best keeper in the league Absolutely. In terms of FPL. So in terms of keeper, I think you have to go for the cheaper one. And in terms of defense, at the start, I think you have to go for cheaper as well, because you're not sure who's going to keep a clean sheet. Later on the season, you have a sense of all the teams and who is able to get a clean sheet more often. Maybe you can go for Trent Alexander-Arnold, or maybe attacking fullbacks that guarantee you some points.
Assist points, absolutely.
Yeah, assist points and not just clean sheets. So that is the reason people go for big hitters at the start of the season. Like, you can guarantee some points, and those players are also massive captain choices. You have to nail your captain as well. So they give you an option to double the points.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go for a cheaper defense and cheaper goalkeepers, you can fit as many premium forwards and midfielders. So I think that's a plus as well.
Yep.
Yeah, right. But, you know, talking about the cheaper defenders in the beginning, it's fine. But there are some, you know, on-point players. Like, we are again talking about Alexander-Arnold, Robertson, maybe Ruben Dias as well. Like, last season he performed very well. So there are certain players which you need to have in your starting 11, be it in the starting or in the middle of the season, because they are almost there, you know, to give you those points which are will be for the clean sheet, maybe for someone from scoring a goal or, you know, making assists or something. So these 2-3 players, I think, should be, you know, players to watch out for from the perspective of the throughout the season, because these players, they are match winners on their own. On their own day, they'll score also, they'll defend also, they'll do everything. So, and the plus point, obviously, like, if a defender scores goals or, you know, assists, so you'll get extra points, right? And as Vikram already mentioned, the choice of captain. You keep a clean sheet, you score a goal, you have a very good day, and you get so many points from this one player only. So these things also need to be kept in mind, I think.
Fair enough. All right. So this brings to my second question as well, because when you are obviously, you know, making your team, as I said, majority of us managers, what we do is we don't invest heavily in defense. So is one of the approach that I could find was that those 100 millions I can divide, you know, between the goalkeepers and defense, between the midfield and between my forward line. So this what this will help me with is that obviously I'll have a balanced squad. I'll have players who can contribute to my points from every position, but I'll also have a balanced bench as well. Because sometimes what happens is that, you know, one of your key players or premium players like Salah or Kane, they can get suspended for one match or injured for one match. And then it doesn't make sense to make a whole transfer just to waste your transfer just to, you know, get the go, you know, just transfer them out for that particular game week for which they are suspended, and then bring them back again when their suspension is lifted. So should we do something like, you know, we can, you know, differentiate, you know, we can divide our budget with respect to each position. Just say that if for our initial 100 million pounds, we can divide the 9 to 10 millions for the two goalkeepers, 24 to 29 million for the five defenders, 36 to 40 million for the five midfielders, and 25 to 30 millions for the strikers. So is budget allocation something that we should look at while making our team? Not entirely, of course, eye test and everything else that we discussed during the first question. Obviously, I think those are most important, but is this one of, I don't think many people do this, but could this be one of a differential approach to build our initial 11 by dividing the budget, you know, position wise?
It's an interesting approach, but personally, I am not that mathematical in FPL terms. I choose the cheapest keeper. I put the big hitters in my team first, and then I decide who can I get. So that is my approach. But this is interesting because also this ensures that if you plan your transfers as well, like if you have balanced your squad and you have you know that if you have to change one of your premiums, you have allocated that money and you can instantly sign another player who is of a similar range, and you can plan that transfer beforehand. So if you have a balanced squad, you have allocated your funds in the forward line, in the midfield line, you can easily interchange players in those areas. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a plus in this approach. But personally, I go with my gut in these things. Get the players who have performed well in the last seasons. Uh-huh. And then I put in a couple of differentials and some players who have easy fixtures. So that's my approach.
Yeah, and you know, we should consider one more thing here. Like, there has been Euro Championship recently, right?
Yeah.
So many players are coming back from the holidays. So maybe some of them are not, you know, up to their fitness level 100%, and they won't be playing in the week, like starting at least, not in the first game week or the second, and not to their fitness levels. So maybe that will also, you know, have a part to play in the game week. And course, coming yeah. to the previous point, yeah, just 1 minute. Coming to the previous point, which Sushain mentioned before, like having cheap defenders or maybe having the defenders who don't play that all, they're fringed out of the starting 11. So at this very point, at this very moment, we can say, like if Salah, maybe Son, maybe Kane, any one of them have, you know, being suspended for one game or maybe having a small niggle, so they don't play the one game which they are not going to be fit for. So we can easily substitute them for another player who has, like, maybe we have a defender over there, right? So if we are playing a 3-5-2, we can easily put it and make sure it's a 4-4-2 or something like that. And that also, you know, maybe it would balance out the points as well. Maybe the defender which we bring in, he, you know, his team keeps a clean sheet somehow. We don't know these things, right? So that will balance out the points as well. And this is a very important fact, I think, which we should consider.
Absolutely. And I think it's obviously, I think there is a lot more planning that that is required for this kind of approach. The one thing that it happens with what it can do with this particular approach is because when the fact that you have a balanced squad, you can, you know, shuffle your squad between from the starting 11 from the bench week in and week out, because you know that since your squad is balanced, obviously your bench players are going to play as well. You know, they'll be definite starters for their team. So given the fact that because of the fact that you have a balanced squad, then you can see the future fixtures of your, you know, of your players. And if you think that some one particular player on your bench has an easier looking couple of fixtures in the future, so you can, you know, get him in the starting 11, and then hopefully he'll reap more points for you than the player who was in your starting 11 previously. Yeah, so as Vikram said, you know, he likes to go by his gut. I think I don't think many of us go with this approach of, you know, allocating your budget. As I said, it was a differential approach. I think not many people do this, but all the mathematicians out there who like to, you know, As I say, then, you know, plan their monthly expenses, plan their investments.
All these Pep Guardiolas out there.
Right, exactly.
All the Pep Guardiolas out there, all the people who sold their RD Sharmas in their 10th and 12th standards. Please, you can go by this mathematical approach. Hopefully this will be beneficial for you. I think I'll try this as well. Maybe not, but I think it's kind of I kind of like this approach. But we'll see how we go, because there are some players who are going to be in my team for sure. I won't care about the future fixtures. I won't care about their price. I won't care about anything else. But I know that those couple of players are going to be definitely in my starting 11, in my squad throughout the season. And these are some of the players who you never transfer out. So with this brings me to my next question as well, that these premium players that we have, you know, who are obviously valued the highest. By highest, I mean either 12 million pounds or more than 12 million pounds. So Salah, I remember one season he was the most expensive player with 13 million pounds, but I think his cost has reduced to 12.5. So the four or five players that we have, which we can put into that premium section, which cost more than 12.5. Obviously, Mohamed Salah, Harry Kane, I think Bruno Fernandes, Kevin De Bruyne, and I think these four itself. So how do we go about, how many premium players should we have in our squad? Obviously, you know, if we try to have at least, you cannot have all four premium players in your team. But even if we have three premium players, then obviously there will be some areas where we won't be able to compensate that money for. So about the structure that we discussed, you know, the kind of formations, I think that those will play also a very big part in figuring out as to how many premium players that we can have in our team. So obviously, you know, we cannot have four, and obviously you would not want to have just one. So obviously the big question is that do we keep two premium players in our team or do we go with three?
I think we can easily fit three premium players, right? Two in the midfield and one forward. I think.
Yep.
Talking about the season, I think Salah and Bruno Fernandes and Kane, I think these three are the must-haves in my opinion. Like Shivang mentioned that he might have Kevin De Bruyne in the team, but I think he has dropped the level, and he was injured as well in the Euros.
Last season,
he played with a broken ligament. tear in his ankle.
Torn ligament, absolutely.
Yeah, torn ligaments, yeah. So these three have to be in my team. I think we can easily fit these three.
Yeah, it balances out the squad, you know? It balances out the squad as well, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
But there's also Trent Alexander-Arnold who is pushing into my team.
One of the premiums if you go for the defense, yeah. I think only he is the one who costs more than £7 million, right, amongst the defenders. Or Robertson as well.
Robertson, I think.
Only two.
The same price, isn't it?
Yeah.
7.5. Yeah.
Last season, they were brilliant. And that's why many people had both of them in the starting last season. But after Van Dijk's injury, they just didn't keep any clean sheets. And it turned out to be a bad decision to keep both of them.
Yeah. And then,
so I think this season, the players will be cautious to keep both of them in the starting 11.
Yeah, and didn't even contribute, you know, with the attacking contributions, you know, with goals or assists, which could have compensated those points which they lost for their clean sheets. So this brings me to another question. As the word that you used for these kind of players, must-haves. So majority of the people, you know, the 8 crore people who play this game throughout, you know, across the world, I think majority of those, obviously more than half of those would want to keep these three must-have players, right? Either Bruno Fernandes, Mohamed Salah, Kevin De Bruyne, or Harry Kane. So obviously if everyone has the same players, you'll get the same points. And to make sure that you're getting points above your more than your rivals or your friends with whom you compete with, you need to have those differential players. So now these differential players are obviously like, you know, players like Jesse Lingard who just burst the scene, you know, during the latter part of the season. People bought him in as soon as he scored, played in that first game for West Ham and made him captain. So obviously not many people had Jesse Lingard as captain, and those differential points really make a difference towards the end of the season. So this is obviously another question that we got from our listeners and viewers, was that how do we approach with the differential transfers? Should we like keep the differential transfers from the beginning itself, or should we wait till the January window or maybe for February and March? And obviously when we have the option of that second wildcard, or should we bring those differential forwards, differential players later into the season, or should we keep them in our team from the beginning itself?
Yeah, I think differentials, you have to have, I think, 2 or 3 at the start, because you can experiment a bit.
Absolutely.
If you have your must-haves, you have to experiment a bit to gain an advantage in the start. Like if you don't have an advantage at the start, you'll just be like, you can't cover up that gap.
Absolutely.
You have to, yeah. So 2 to 3 differentials, but you have to be cautious because they are not a guarantee, and especially the newcomers who are coming from the championship, you can't guarantee points from those teams. So you have to like watch those players. If you are going for some differentials, you have to really watch those players in the first few weeks, and then only you can decide on keeping them. But 2 to 3, I think you should go for them
from the beginning itself.
Yeah, from the beginning,
from game week 1. Okay. Shivang, do you differ in opinion or?
Yeah, I was about to. This is a point of concern for me, at least, that the consistency needs to be on the top, right? So these must-haves, they'll perform, come what may, maybe not in game week 1, not in game week 2, but after that, they will. So these 2 to 3 differentials, which we already discussed about, so they won't be consistent throughout, maybe. Maybe someone will have a dip in form. Maybe someone will actually score many goals and assists for 1 or 2 game weeks, and then the form will dip. So these 2 to 3 players which we need to choose, it has to be very, you know, a very thoughtful decision, actually. And I remember when Wolves were playing on the top of their, you know, game like a season ago or 2 seasons ago, when they were almost competing for the, you know, European competitions, Euros, Championships. So they had Joe Martinho, they had Ruben Neves, Jimenez, Diogo Jota, who was recently transferred to Liverpool. So these type of players, at least we can trust upon. But as Vikram mentioned already, players coming from Championship or maybe from other leagues as well. So we don't know how they perform in the Premier League. We don't know what type of, you know, game they will bring to the pitch. Will, like, will they, you know, take time to gel up with their new teams or something like that? So these two to three points which we need to take care of. The rest everything is, I think, on point. We choose between the players which we have, the must-haves, then the players which have proven experience in the Premier League, like the players I mentioned about from Wolves. So these two to three players, they will be a difference, yeah.
I think if you get your differentials, if you get your differentials right, that will be the biggest boost you can get.
Absolutely.
And
FPL is not a sprint; it's a marathon. So this is where your transfers come in. Yeah. So if you know that, let's just say that a couple of seasons ago, because obviously Premier League starts in August, and we have to, make our FPL team in August. So a few seasons ago, Harry Kane, as we know, you know, he very quickly became the must-have in your team. So Harry Kane had this particular record of not having scored even a single goal in August. So when the season used to start, people used to, you know, think about whether they should get Harry Kane from the beginning, because obviously he doesn't score much goals in August, and keep him on the bench or play someone else, or should we get another forward and then, you know, transfer Harry Kane later in maybe September when you're sure that he'll score goals. So I think this is where you need to be very proactive with your transfers, given the fact that you will get one free transfer every week. And obviously, you know, you need to, if you're going to make a big money signing, you'll need to transfer at least two players out to make sure that you have enough budget to get a premium player in. Yeah. So I think this is where you need to be very tricky with your transfers, which brings to me to my next question. I think this is something that I did last season. I never did this, you know, in the previous 5-6 seasons that I've been playing this Premier FPL for. So this is something that I particularly did a lot during last season, was that I took a transfer hit. I took a points hit. Even when I had only one free transfer left, I used to, you know, just on my impulse or just because of a gut feeling, I used to use an extra transfer which used to cost me 4 points. So is this, do you guys advise this, that, you know, should we, obviously one point that will come forward is that if we are taking a point hit for, then we should make sure that the player that we're bringing in is going to definitely get us more than 4 points to compensate for that. So do you guys advise this? Do you guys advise to take a points hit to get a player in?
No, I think you should... You should take the least hits possible. But last season was a very different season. Yeah. You had COVID and you had so many stoppages in the season. Mm-hmm. So you have to keep that in mind as well. If maybe this season also you could have some stoppages. So you have to keep some transfers in reserve as well. You have to plan for that as well.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe sometimes you have to take a hit, and that is okay. I think 3 to 4 or 5 hits per season is okay, but you have to keep a hold of yourself and don't go overbound in that regard.
Over impulse.
Yeah, not
right.
Yeah,
but you know, I think it's situational. Like if you have a player of a caliber of Bruno Fernandes, De Bruyne, or any other, even when we mentioned about Jesse Lingard, who has been showing good performance, you know, getting these points and displaying good performances at the end of the last season. So if you don't have a player of that caliber in your team and you transfer him in and take a hit, obviously, and then he guarantees you much more points, right? So I think that's a gamble, which is a calculated risk, and you can compensate on that 4 points lost. So
You don't have him in your team, then you're not doing well anyway. You exactly. Shouldn't put him out.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I have to believe this.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. So the thing with the, I think the, what we can conclude from this topic is that even if you're taking a points hit to make an additional transfer, make sure that it's very, very calculated. Even if your player is not going to fetch you points in that particular game week where you did take a points hit, make sure that his upcoming fixtures are kinder to him so that he'll compensate with those 4 points that he lost last season. Yeah. Which brings me to my next question now, which majority of the players ask, and this is something that I personally struggle with as well, that how do we keep our club loyalties aside? while making transfers. So last season, I think majority what a lot of people did was obviously given Timo Werner's goal scoring form, I think everyone had him in from the beginnings, and he didn't and he didn't perform well for the first three matches. I think he registered only one assist, but then he scored two goals and one assist against Southampton, which obviously, you know, repaid the patience. But then again, I think given the fact how his season went, I kept him for a very, very long time, hoping that he would score in the next game week. I even used to write him on Twitter that Timos, please score you. I have you in my fantasy Premier League team from game week one. But we all know how it went. He did win penalties and he did register assists. But yeah, I think given his price, which was £9.5 million, I think it wasn't worth it. So how important it is to keep club loyalties aside when you're playing FPL?
I think it's imperative. It is the most important thing. And even I have struggled. I mean, I had Timo Werner as well from the start.
Two Chelsea fans over here.
Yeah. I kept my patience till I think 5 weeks, and then I didn't bring him back ever. And I don't think I'll keep him in my team this season as well. He's not reliable in FPL terms.
Inconsistent.
Not on the pitch as well. I have to say this.
Well, hopefully he is, but...
Yeah, you can hope so.
And none of the Chelsea attackers are. I mean, even in the preseason game against Arsenal, they missed quite a lot of chances. So it's very tricky with a lot of clubs. You have to pick your players, you know, very, you know, every transfer has to be very calculated.
Right. And, you know, talking about Manchester United, I can still name three players which I will keep in my first game week. It has to be Jadon Sancho, Bruno Fernandes, and even though I want to keep Varane, Maguire, both of them, but I'll keep Luke Shaw.
Luke Shaw. Yeah,
on the form basis, totally on the form basis.
Yeah, this again brings me to another question, is that obviously you know you can only keep three players from one team in your team. So given that it's the first game week and you don't know which players are going to perform, which players are going to play, which players are going to be in your team. So should we triple out on one club from the game week one itself, or do you think because we have 20 clubs to choose from, or should we keep one player each from one club just to get a gist of as to how every club is performing, and what after 8 or 10 game weeks when we know that which club is performing and which players are going to be consistently performing for that particular club, then should we triple out on one club, as in just to get three players from one particular club in your starting 11? Or should we do this from the first game week itself?
Yeah, in my opinion, it's not a yes or no answer. It depends on the situation. If there's a team like Liverpool who has very easy fixtures, and you know that Salah and Trent and Robertson or Mane will start the games, or Jota.
Yeah.
So it's okay to have three players of those teams. Mm-hmm. And even Man City, like these teams who, you know, that can easily get many, like 10 plus points per player.
Yep.
So I think it's logical to have three players of those teams.
Fair enough.
Right. It has to be like that.
All right. So another question is, similar to the question that I had asked a couple of questions ago, what is the level of patience that we need to show with some of our premium or semi-premium players? Obviously, premium players 12 and 12.5, semi-premium players between 9 to 12.5. What is the level of patience that we need to show with these particular players whose price is relatively on the higher side if they are not performing? You know, obviously, I remember we had Son last season. We had him, I think he cost about around £9 million. So we had him for the first few fixtures. He didn't perform. I think Spurs lost their first game, only managed to win by a goal or a two in the next few fixtures. And obviously many of us transferred Heung-min Son out. But then it came the game against Southampton where he scored 4 goals. So obviously those who were patient with him, he did kind of reward them. But obviously those players who were not patient, you know, it was their head in their hand situation. So this is my question, that what is the level of patience that we need to show with the semi-premium or premium players I mean, for how long, for how many game weeks should we wait for them to perform? Let's just say that if we have a premium player in Mohamed Salah from the beginning itself, and he blanks for the first two game weeks, should we take him out, get another premium in, or should we be patient with him for at least a couple more game weeks?
You know, Vikram, may I go ahead with this one?
Yeah, sure.
I think we need to keep a patience level of Sushain and Vikram, which they kept with Timo Werner. That's the level of patience we need to have.
But that is for the players. Yes. That is a completely different scenario that comes under your club loyalty. I'm saying if obviously I don't think any Chelsea player falls in that bracket this season. I think Kai Havertz is the most expensive player with 8.5. If we sign Erling Haaland, I think he might be that semi-premium player. But I don't think any Chelsea player is falling in that category this season. But yeah, how many game weeks do we stay patient with them?
You know, with the must-haves, you can never be too patient or, you know, less patient. Because the players which you already mentioned, like Son, then Salah, Fernandes, maybe De Bruyne as well, Harry Kane, they don't score in one game, two game week, third game week, but then they go on a flurry of goals. So with these must-have players, these big names, we can never be sure. And talking about the normal ones, like the mid-range ones, maybe we can take example of Timo Werner, maybe Kai Havertz, who had a slow start to the season, but then he flourished. So these things need to be kept in mind. And not only these, but the ones which will bring in the transfer window, like you mentioned, Erling Haaland. Well, he's a goal machine. You can't say, yeah, okay, I can't keep him in from the game week one or two. Then he'll go on a flurry of scoring goals. So yeah, these two to three points which we need to take care about. The players which we have, the must-haves, the premium players, we can obviously, you know, trust them. We can have them on the head. Like you have already mentioned, Harry Kane didn't score goals for 2 to 3 seasons in the month of August in the first few game weeks, right? But still ended up as the Golden Boot winner. Absolutely. At the end of the season. So it's never too late for them, right? For the fringe players, for the players which are like on lower level, maybe we should, you know, take the risk and transfer them out, most probably.
Okay. Yeah, the premium players have some leeway. Because if you transfer them out and many players already have those, like they have 50% plus ownership, then it will hurt your rank a lot if you drop that player.
Absolutely.
And he gets a lot of points. Mm-hmm. And these players are also captain choices every week, week out.
Yep.
So there's a risk involved in that. Absolutely. For the semi-premium players, I think you have to, if you trust in your players and if you are serious about why you have chosen those players, you should at least give them 3 weeks to perform. Okay. And analyze on that basis. There's a term called knee-jerking in FPL terms. So yeah, you should avoid doing that. Like if he doesn't perform for 1 week and you just transfer him out and the next week he scores a hat-trick. So that is very possible. That is FPL.
Yeah. Going after the term that you mentioned, the knee-jerk reactions that we do, you mentioned the knee-jerk reaction with respect to the player not performing and us transferring him out. What about a player who performs? Because let's just say that on Saturday, you know, we have a game, Aston Villa versus Brighton, and Ollie Watkins ends up scoring a hat-trick. So obviously, on Saturday, he scores a hat-trick, and on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, you know, people will start bringing him in because the knee-jerk reaction happens both ways. If your player is not performing, you would want to get him out. But if you see a player performing so well, you'll want to bring him in. And obviously, you know, when the players start buying more players, their price starts increasing as well. So given the fact that if we are very proactive with our transfers, we want to make one transfer at least, you know, minimum one transfer every game week. How long should we wait for this transfer? Like, should we do it immediately after the game week starts? Because we know that a player performing or player not performing will end up increasing or decreasing his value, which will affect your overall budget as well. So how long do we wait for, you know, to make a transfer or to, you know, to make a transfer, to sell a player or buy a player?
Yeah, first of all, you have to analyze his performance. Like, was it a fluke? Or did he really play well that game?
Okay.
And, yeah. So then you have to get him in quickly. Like, it's called jumping on the train.
Absolutely.
Like, if you are 2 to 3 weeks late, then it's not a differential anymore. You have to jump on that train quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. So, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then, right. Then obviously it's not a differential anymore because a lot of people have already got him. So you won't be able to compensate on his points. Fair enough.
And, you know, I believe these points, these, you know, minute details, they mean a lot at the end of the season. Like, there are people who have only been separated by a point or two, and the rank is like mammoth difference in the rankings, right? We can, you know, take example of our own league also, like the one which we play among ourselves.
Yeah.
2 to 3 points difference, and then we see a rank being so different. So these 2 to 3 point differences make a lot at the end, you know, they compensate at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, last season, Bamford was a big differential, and many people doubted him. Like, he got many points in the starting weeks, and still many people doubted him.
Yeah.
I mean, even I didn't jump on that train very quickly.
Absolutely.
But after 2 or 3 weeks, I did jump on that train and got rewarded. But still, many people didn't.
Yeah, even I didn't jump on the Dominic Calvert-Lewin train. I think even he was playing very well in the beginning of the season. I think he consistently played well. And even I thought that this was just a fluke and he was going to end up with blanks, but obviously he didn't. So even I suffered in that case. But yeah, I mean, that's how it goes. I mean, at the end of the day, everything is calculated. Either you plan everything or either it's just your gut feeling. And obviously, you know, both have their pros and cons. And you realize what went right and what went wrong when the season ends. Yep. So I think that's it. I think these were the 8 or 10 questions that we got from our viewers and listeners. I hope when this episode comes out, their questions would have been answered and they would have picked up sufficient tips and advices to make their FPL team. So one question, I think both with respect to us that I need to ask both of you, that what are your, I'm sure we are still more than 10 days away from the FPL, but I know that, you know, you've already started making that your game week one squad in your minds, even if you haven't on the app. So which are the top five which are the five must have players that you've already decided that you are definitely going to have in your game week one squad?
Yeah, number one is Ross Barkley.
Ross Barkley, and second one.
Second one is Timmy. I can't pronounce his first name, but it is
Timmy Bakayoko. Third must Bakayoko. Be. Yeah. Third must be.
Is he still in
water.
Chelsea? Is he still in Chelsea?
Yeah.
Not keeping out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Jokes apart, I think the first name is Mohamed Salah.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone will have. I don't have to speak like his name.
Yeah.
And second one, it doesn't matter if he goes to City or not. I think Kane will be and should be in everyone's team, even if he has that August curse.
Mm-hmm.
But if he goes to City, I mean, what curse can prevent him scoring in City, man?
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely.
Yeah. Third one will be Bruno Fernandes.
Mm-hmm.
He was immense for Man U. Like, he's on penalties, which is important.
Absolutely.
He scores, set goals, pieces, he assists, he takes free
very
kicks.
Important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's a midfielder. He gets an extra point for clean sheet.
And for
which he doesn't have to do anything, but yeah, and for scoring goal. And the fourth one, I think, was a very improved player last season. Rafinha from Leeds. I think this could be his breakout season. Like, maybe many clubs will go after him after the season.
Mm-hmm.
He was very exciting to look. And the fifth one will be, I think, Trent Alexander-Arnold. He was very good at the back end of the season.
Yeah.
He's finished strongly. And with Van Dijk coming back and also Liverpool signed Konate, I think they have fixed their back line now and will be a much big contender for keeping clean sheets in the next season. So I think he'll thrive in that team.
Yep.
And so that's my top five.
What's most surprising for me was that none of these five is none of these five is a Chelsea player. So I think this was kind of a little surprising for me. But yeah, fair enough. As we discussed, obviously club loyalties need to be kept aside. So one of the prime examples of that.
And no Man City player as well.
Yeah, no, because you never know which player is going to play. Harry Kane.
Yeah, Harry Kane.
You can put an asterisk with Harry Kane. He either could be a Tottenham player transfer. Or he could be a City player.
Right.
Yeah. So what about Shivang?
So yeah, right. So I'll go with Luke Shaw. The first name on my team sheet has to be Luke Shaw. His performance has been immense in Euros and the season before. Bruno Fernandes, obviously, not only the penalties, which are very important, very difficult to take. Not all the players can take penalties and score, like Sergio Aguero, the recent ones.
Yeah.
And then we have Mohamed Salah, Harry Kane, and one player which I want to keep is Jack Grealish. Again, if he goes to City, if he stays in Aston Villa, doesn't matter. He'll win you penalties, which are again very important. Yeah. He'll give you assists and he'll score goals on his day as well. So these are five players which we need to look out for.
All right, fair enough. So what about Sushain? Both of you picked three premium players. I don't know how you're going to allocate the rest of your budget. But for me, I think it's obviously Mohamed Salah is going to be there because he did not have any summer tournament. He's fully rested. He's going to have a full preseason with Liverpool. So I think his form is going to be very critical from the beginning. So obviously Mohamed Salah. Second player, I think Kai Havertz. I tweeted about this and FPL retweeted me. So I think his performance was very good. I think the way he ended his season, the way he played at the Euros, I think he was Germany's best player. And obviously he scored against Arsenal recently in the preseason match. So Kai Havertz is going to be one of the definite players that I keep in the starting 11. Then I think it's going to be, I think I'm going to choose maybe Ben Chilwell. Not entirely Ben Chilwell because I don't know if he's going to play in the first season because he's only joined the Chelsea camp recently. But I think it'll be one of the Chelsea defenders. I don't know, but maybe. So I think it'll be Mohamed Salah. Kai Havertz, Antonio Rudiger. I think he's definitely going to start the first match at least, which is against Crystal Palace. We might keep a clean sheet. Then I think the remaining two players are going to be for me. I don't know, man. I haven't figured it out. So I think it's okay if I give you three. So I think Kai Havertz, Antonio Rudiger, and Mohamed Salah are the three players that are going to be in my are the three players that are definitely going to be in my game week one squad, and I'll figure out. I am still working out on my approach, man. I might go it with that budget approach or with the eye test or with the different approaches that we've discussed. So I'm still figuring it out. As I told you, I was taking notes, so I'm going to go through my notes before I make my game week one team. But
Shane, just don't be a Pep Guardiola. That's it. No, rest, everything is fine.
Don't overthink too much. I mean, it. I think this is something that I don't think we do it on purpose. I don't think we do it on purpose. It just happens with you.
Yeah, well, exactly.
Especially when making FPL. So I think everyone knows how Pep Guardiola feels when he's selecting his team. When you've got such a huge squad, then obviously you tend to overthink because we have 20 teams to select our players from. So obviously there will be some sort of overthinking. And obviously Pep Guardiola has such a huge pool of talent with him. And obviously if these transfers of Kane and Grealish go through, it's only going to get bigger and bigger. So that's it. That's how it's going to be. So I think that's pretty much it. I think we've come to the end of our episode. I think we've discussed variety of topics, almost all the topics that are there to discuss. Hopefully our viewers and listeners would get a lot of help with this from this episode whenever they are making their FPL teams. So that's pretty much it, guys. We'll be making a Flag Goes Up podcast mini league, and we'll be sharing that league code on our Twitter and Instagram. So make sure that you're joining in. Obviously Vikram is going to be a part of that mini league, and given his track record for the last two or three seasons, I think all of us, the main goal for every one of us should be to dethrone him. You know, 464 All India rank is something. I think it's very impressive. Only those of us who have played FPL know how impressive it is. So we need to dethrone Professor Vikram from his throne, as I said. But yeah, we'll see how it goes. So this is pretty much it, guys. I hope this was informative. This episode was informative for you, the FPL episode. We've got, as I told you, the Premier League is less than 2 weeks away. So we will be doing a game week one preview as well. And obviously, for me and Vikram, Chelsea are playing their first competitive game a little earlier. They will be playing their Super Cup game against Villarreal on, on next Wednesday evening. I think 13th morning. So we'll think of doing an episode on that as well. It's obviously good to start your season with silverware. So we'll see. And obviously that will give us some idea as well as to which Chelsea players are going to start in the game week one of Tuchel's plan. So that will give us some ideas as to which Chelsea players to keep. But yeah, guys, that's pretty much it. We hope that this episode was informative for you. We'll be coming up with the game week one preview of the Premier League very soon. And we might as well decide to do the Super Cup preview as well. But until then, this is it from my side. Keep your eyes out on our Twitter and Instagram. We will be sharing that mini league code with you as soon as we make that league. And make sure to join us and test your strategies, test your skills, test your knowledge about the Premier League against us. Yep. So that's pretty much it, guys. We hope you enjoyed. Stay home. Stay safe. See you soon.